After learning the early theories of crime and the psychological theories in the previous two chapters, let us now try to understand the sociological theories of delinquency causation. There have been a number of different sociological theories of delinquency causation, some dealing with social class and or family differences. Clobbered and Olin 1960, Cohen 1955, Miller 1958, Quinney 1975. Some dealing with blocked educational and occupational goals, Merton 1938. Some dealing with neighborhood and peers, Miller 1958, Shaw and Mackay 1942, Thrasher 1927. And some dealing with the effects of official labeling, Becker 1963. Most of these theories share the notion that delinquent behavior is the product of social interaction rather than the result of heredity or personality disturbance. For sociologists, delinquency must be understood in social context. Thus, we must consider time, place, audience, and nature of the behavior involved when studying delinquency. Anomy and strain theory. Beginning in the 1930s in the United States, a number of theorists focused on a systems model to explain crime and delinquency. Adapting Durkheim's anomy theory, a breakdown of social norms or the dissociation of the individual from a general sense of morality of the times, Merton 1938, focused on the discrepancy between societal goals and the legitimate means of attaining those goals. He argued that a strain is placed on those who wish to pursue societal goals but lack the legitimate means of doing so, strain theory. According to Merton, people adapt to this strain in different ways. Some attempt to play the game, some retreat and may become addicts and outcasts. Some develop innovative responses, including the illegitimate responses of crime and delinquency, and some rebel, another potential source of crime. During the 1950s, Cohen adapted Merton's theory in an attempt to explain juvenile gangs. He argued that lower class juveniles experience the strain of being unsuccessful in middle class terms, especially in the school setting. Because many lower class youth find success in school difficult to achieve, they reject middle class values and seek to gain status by engaging in behaviors contrary to middle class standards. Thus, they establish their own anti-middle class value system and, through mutual recruitment, form delinquent gangs. Miller 1958 disagreed with Cohen's theory that lower class youth act in terms of inverted middle class values. Instead, Miller focused on what he called the focal concerns: toughness, trouble, smartness, fate, autonomy, and excitement of the lower social class as the sources of delinquent behavior. Sykes and Marza 1957 argued in their theory of delinquency and drift that firm commitment to subcultural values was not necessarily a precursor of delinquent behavior, unlike the view of Cohen, Miller, and others. Sykes and Marza viewed delinquency as being based on an extension of defenses to crimes in the form of justifications for deviant behavior that are accepted by delinquents but not necessarily by the legal system or larger society. These defenses were called techniques of neutralization and included denial of responsibility for the consequences of delinquent actions, denial of injury to the victim or larger society, denial of a victim. The victim had it coming. Condemnation of the condemners. As hypocrites or spiteful people appeal to higher loyalties, example to the gang. Using these techniques, juveniles drift in and out of the delinquent subculture over time. Clovered and Olin, 1960. Extended enemy or strain theory. By focusing on the differential opportunities that exist among juveniles. If an illegitimate opportunity structure is readily available, they argued, juveniles who are experiencing strain or enemy are attracted to that structure and are likely to become involved in delinquent activities. In 1985, Agnew again revised strain theory. He discussed three types of strain that may produce deviant behavior. The first is the individual's failure to achieve goals. The second involves loss of a source of stability, example, death of a loved one. And the third occurs when the individual is confronted by negative stimuli, example, lack of success in school. Furthermore, Agnew, 1985, suggested that rather than pursuing specific goals, many people are simply interested in being treated justly based on their own efforts and resources. People who do not perceive themselves to be treated fairly experience a strain, according to Agnew. Reactions to this perception of unfair treatment may lead to crime and delinquency. Later, Agnew 2001 argued that criminal victimization might be among the most consequential strains experienced by adolescents and, therefore, might be an important cause of delinquency. Subsequently, Hay and Evans 2006 examined predictions from general strain theory about the effects of victimization on later involvement in delinquency. They concluded that violent victimization significantly predicted later involvement in delinquency. Even when controlling for the individual's earlier involvement in delinquency, and that the effects of victimization were slightly greater for juveniles with weak emotional attachment to their parents and significantly greater for those low in self-control. Using a sample of homeless street youth, Barron, 2004, examined how specific forms of strain, including emotional abuse, physical abuse, sexual abuse, homelessness, being a victim of robbery, being a victim of violence, being a victim of theft, relative deprivation, monetary dissatisfaction, and unemployment are related to crime and drug use. He also explored how strain is conditioned by deviant peers. Deviant attitudes, external attributions, self-esteem, and self-efficacy. He concluded that all 10 types of strain examined can lead to criminal behavior either as main effects or when interacting with conditioning variables. Hay and Evans, 2006, examined the stressful effects of being violently victimized on later delinquency. Consistent with strain theory, the authors found that being a victim of violence increased a youth's subsequent delinquency and that the effects of such victimization on delinquency were somewhat mediated by the youth's feelings of anger. As feelings of anger increased, so did involvement in delinquency. When anger was controlled, the direct effects of victimization on delinquency were reduced and the youth's level of self-control was related to coping with victimization in that youth who were impulsive and demonstrated low self-control had more difficulty in coping. Hollist, Hux and Scavell, 2009, focusing on parent-child problems as a source of strain leading to delinquency, found a significant association between maltreatment and delinquency. Their findings supported strain theory as they found negative emotions to be important intervening mechanism in this relationship. However, contrary to the tenets of strain theory, they noted that the direct effects of the negative emotions were equally, if not more, important for involvement in delinquency than the direct effect of maltreatment. Finally, partial support for general strain theory was reported by Sunoki and Pusova, 2009, who found that Asian youth who responded to school-related stress with anger and frustration were more likely to commit future delinquent acts. At the same time, however, the study failed to show a significant relationship among strain negative effect and gang involvement among Asian youth. The hypothesis that stress produced by generational conflict would increase gang involvement and delinquency was not supported. Instead, results showed that youth involved in such conflict were less likely to engage in future delinquent acts. The researchers hypothesized that this may be a result of the nature and structure of family relationships among Asian Americans. There are numerous criticisms of strain anomaly theory. It tends to focus almost exclusively on lower class delinquency. It also ignores the effects of labeling and fails to explain why many juveniles who undoubtedly experience strain do not turn to delinquency as a means of attaining their goals. As is the case with many of the other theories discussed previously, the verdict on strain anomaly theory is still out. Ecological social disorganization approach. The ecological social disorganization approach to explaining crime and delinquency was developed during the 1930s and 1940s and is one of the oldest interest areas of American criminologists. This approach focuses on the geographic distribution of delinquency. Shaw and Mackay, 1942, and later others found that crime and delinquency rates were not distributed equally within cities. They mapped the areas marked by high crime and delinquency rates along with the socioeconomic problems of those areas. Using Burgess, 1952, concentric zone theory of city growth, the ecological social disorganization studies generally found that zones of transition between residential and industrial neighborhoods consistently had the highest rates of crime and delinquency. These zones are characterized by physical deterioration and are located adjacent to the business district of the central city. The neighborhoods in this zone are marked by deteriorating buildings and substandard housing with accompanying overcrowdedness, lack of sanitation, and generally poor health and safety conditions. In addition, the area is marked by a transient population, high unemployment rates, poverty, broken homes, and a high adult crime rate. In short, the area is characterized by a general lack of social stability and cohesion or social disorganization. Wills, 1967, best summarized early ecological social disorganization studies and their findings on the distribution of delinquency. Her conclusions were as follows. Rates of delinquency and crime vary widely in different neighborhoods and within a city or town. The highest crime and delinquency rates generally occur in the low rent areas located near the center of the city, and the rates decrease with increasing distance from the city center. High delinquency rate areas tend to maintain their rates over time, although the population composition of the area may change radically within the same time period. Areas that have high rates of truancy also have high rates of juvenile court cases and high rates of male delinquency, and usually have high rates of female delinquency. The differences in area rates reflect differences in community background. High rate areas are characterized by things such as physical deterioration and declining population, The delinquency rates for particular nationality and ethnic groups show the same general tendency as the entire population, namely, they are high in the central area of the city and low as the group move toward the outskirts of the city. Delinquents living in areas with high delinquency rates are the most likely to become recidivists and are likely to appear in court several times more often than are those living in areas with low delinquency rates. In summary, delinquency and crime follow the pattern of social and physical structures of the city, with concentration occurring in disorganized, deteriorated areas. According to Wills, 1967, to predict delinquency using the ecological social disorganization approach, it is necessary to be aware of the existing social structure, social processes, and population composition, as well as the area's position with the large urban societal complex, because these variables all affect the distribution of delinquency. In general, this approach found that family and neighborhood stability were lacking and that the street environment was the prevailing determinant of behavior. If delinquent behavior is learned behavior, this learning would be maximized in environments such as those in transitional zones. In transitional zones, those agencies or institutions that traditionally produce stability, cohesion and organization have often been replaced by the street environment of adult criminals and delinquent gangs. The ecological social disorganization approach to explaining delinquency has been challenged on the grounds that using only one variable to explain delinquency is not likely to lead to success. In Landers, 1970, study of Baltimore, for example, he found anomie or normlessness to be a more appropriate explanation of delinquency rates than socioeconomic area. Nonetheless, follow-up studies by Shaw and Mackay, 1969, in other American cities, Boston, Philadelphia, and Cleveland, support their contention that official delinquency rates decrease from the central city out to the suburbs. Similarly, Lyle and Skipper, 1981, found that significantly less delinquent activity was reported by rural youth than by urban youth in their study of juveniles in detention. Stark, 1987, concluded that certain geographic areas, those characterized by high population density, poverty, transience, and dilapidation, attract deviant people who drive out those who are not so deviant, and those places then become deviant places where high crime rates and weak social control. Whatever the cause, the fact remains the high official delinquency rates are found in certain areas or types of areas where serious and repetitive misconduct not only is common but also appears to have become traditional and more or less acceptable. Lovenkamp, Cullen and Pratt, 2003. There is a real danger here, however, of drawing false conclusions based on what has been called the ecological fallacy. This term refers to false conclusions drawn from analyzing data at one level, example, the group level, and applying those conclusions at another level, example, the individual level. In short, group crime rates tell us nothing about whether a particular individual is likely to become involved in crime. Baum, 2001. In spite of these criticisms, Moyer, 2001, found that one can find the early development of the interactionist perspective, control theory, and conflict theory in their works. Integrated theories, numerous attempts have been made to combine two or more pre-existing theories in an attempt to provide more comprehensive explanations. Integrated theories of criminal and delinquent behavior. The resulting theories or conceptual schemes are far too numerous to discuss here, but we mention a few of the more prominent attempts. Development and Life Course Theory, DLC, attempts to explain how antisocial behavior develops, how different risk factors exist at different stages of life, and the differential effects of life events and antisocial behavior. Moffitt, 1993 to 2006, developed a life course persistent adolescence limited theory that attempts to explain two types of antisocial behavior using biological, psychological, and sociological approaches. According to Moffitt, antisocial behavior either persists across the life course or is limited to adolescence. Those that persist in crime suffer from neuropsychological problems that begins in prenatal development and lead to psychological disorders during childhood that facilitate the delinquent behaviors. Offenders that persist across the life course also grow up in disadvantaged neighborhoods and suffer from inadequate parenting. Moffitt, 1993 to 2006. According to Hagen and Parker, 1999, for example, life course capitalization theory proposes that low intergenerational educational aspirations and educational underachievement is disadvantageous to adolescents and that subsequent adult and parenting problems may well result from this disadvantage. Thus, a parent's educational disinvestment as an adolescent leads to dropping out of school, teen parenthood, unemployment, and marriage and parenting problems, all of which contribute to the intergenerational causation of delinquency among children and adolescents. Interactional theory represents an attempt to combine social learning, social bonding, and social structural theories. Thornsberry, 1987. This theory holds that like all other human social behavior, delinquency is the result of interactions among individuals and is the result of the learning and exchanges that occur in such interaction. Thus, understanding interaction among juveniles and their parents, siblings, peers, gang members, school personnel, and others is critical. Interaction with gang members, for example, may increase the level of delinquent behavior among new members. But those who leave the gang and interact with others who may be less criminally inclined become less likely to engage in behaviors encouraged by the gang. Other integrated theories that you may wish to examine further include network analysis, control balance theory, and strain control theories. As noted, integrated theories represent attempts to improve on our understanding of delinquent behavior and have inspired considerable research. Ultimately, those proposing such theories are searching for commonalities among existing theories that will form the background for a more comprehensive theory. This is important because, as we mentioned earlier, all criminological theories have implications for criminal justice, policy, and practice. Akers and Sellers, 2004. Conclusion. In these three chapters, we have provided a brief overview of some of the attempts to explain delinquency. It should be clear at this point that using a definition of theory, few, if any, of these attempts have resulted in explanations that are scientifically sound. Many have been more or less discarded over time, and others continue to provide leads that need to be pursued. Bridging the gap between theory and practice is crucial to controlling delinquency and to improving the juvenile justice network. The input of practitioners is extremely useful in testing our theoretical statements. The benefits to be reaped if and when a sound theoretical base is established are considerable. We can no longer afford to ignore the importance of theory, nor can we continue to rely on common sense notions of possession that are, as we have seen, very often inaccurate. The sociological approach suggests methods of control and rehabilitation that do not require the death penalty, the practice of eugenics, or complete restructuring of the individual's personality. This approach suggests that positive reinforcement administered in surroundings where the juvenile lives and by those with whom the juvenile regularly interacts may provide more positive results than do many techniques currently employed. Although the sociological approach is not a panacea, it does provide a number of leads for further research and treatment that may prove to be beneficial provided that public and agency cooperation can be obtained. Finally, the search for new better theories of delinquency continues in attempts to combine the tenets of different theories into more comprehensive theories that do a better job of explaining delinquent behavior. Ultimately, the success or failure of policies and practices in the field of juvenile delinquency is determined by the accuracy of explanations for its existence and persistence.